specialist right here. Captain Mike Gallo of Angling Adventures of Louisiana. AA and LA has nothing to do with alcohol. Captain Mike, a professional seminar speaker. Alright, Captain Mike, talk a little bit about, you know, I think, how you started, what areas you fished. There's nothing there, it's a blank page.
I'm Captain Mike Gallo. I've been fishing on the North Shore in Slidell professionally, full-time since 99. I worked for a couple of years part-time before going full-time. Right there on the North Shore by Salt Lake.
Let's start with this gentleman right here talking about triple tail. It's kind of like the cycle of salt water, I'd say. You know, people have a lot of questions about it. You hear all kind of reports. I haven't seen one. I haven't seen any around the around the crab traps. So that's where you target them. Talk about why triple tail are around crab traps.
Well, that's a good question. Why they're around crab traps. And I can tell you the earliest I've ever caught triple tail was in Maine. And I'm very conscious of water temperature. So I can remember seeing a triple tail and immediately looking at my depth finder, which tells me temperature. And the temperature was 74 degrees. The latest I've ever caught them was in October. And coincidentally, the temperature was 74 degrees. So I firmly believe 74 degrees and higher. The reason they hang out around crab traps, you can catch them by anything that's floating or anything that's breaking the surface. It doesn't necessarily have to be something floating. I catch them by PVC poles in Lake Pontchartrain. I'm sorry, in Lake Borgne. Just anything that'll break the surface, and they'll lay on their side or they'll position themselves vertical down current from whatever structure it is they're hiding out on. It's all speculation, but I feel like if he gets close enough to whatever it is that he's hanging out by, he looks like a part of it. And then he's looking into the current. They're sort of like redfish. They're not very fast. They're kind of powerful, but they're not very fast. So I believe he just hangs out real close and sits real still. And when something comes by, he'll dart out and get it. But it's more like hunting than it is fishing. And you actually see 80% of the ones that you catch. And I run past them like a crab boat, picking up his traps, and you just look for them. And you can't miss them. They're black and as big as this seat. So pretty simple to see, you know, the more clear the water is, sometimes it might be a couple of feet down, and sometimes directly on the surface. They're pretty easy to see. When you see them, make a U-turn, come up from behind them, shrimp under a cork, throw it ahead of it, and let it float, just like what he's looking for. When he hits it, a lot of times he'll bite it but not go down. So you'll watch him eat the shrimp, but your cork doesn't go down. So you just sit there, you know, you feel like you got him. As soon as you hook him, you need to throw the rope in reverse and pull yourself away from the trap because he'll get wound up in the rope.
Any more questions about triple tail? You feel like you
got to
use shrimp?
What's that?
You feel like you have to use shrimp? One question.
No, I've caught them on live shrimp, dead shrimp, cockahoes, pogie, spinnerbait, spoons, suspending lures. They're fairly aggressive. If you're kind of far away from him and you cast to him and you see him following the shrimp, you can just keep reeling and he'll come away from that rope. But you run the risk of him getting close enough to see you and then he's gone. So it changes from fish to fish. When he takes off, then I know I was following him too close, and then other times I catch him. I know I did several shows with the big fish with Captain C.T. Williams. We caught some last year in August. And then the river was high, the Pearl River was high. And we wasn't anywhere near the Pearl River, but the Pearl River got to be really high, and a lot of lily pads came out. We caught them under lily pads. I was over by 3 Mile and 9 Mile on the opposite side of the Lakes and Lake Borgne.
Do you feel like around the Grandma's with this grass that's clearly at the Grandma line, structure line?
If you catch them, when you go to clean them, directly on the bottom of his stomach is really, really hard. I mean, it's really hard. It scales, but it's really, really hard. And I've seen him swim into the crab flute and hit it with his belly, and they'll dislodge little crabs that are inside the flute hanging on that rope. And then he'll come back and catch the crab because they're not that long. But he uses it like a weapon. He uses it like a weapon.
Talk a little bit about what you're seeing, how late you've been out, today. What you're seeing out there is maybe a water report, what you think of what's going to happen, this weekend. If we don't see the current today out past this next week, you think things will shape up this week?
The forecast is for a 50% chance of rain, PM showers on Sunday, a 90% chance of rain Monday. Now, we all live in Louisiana. We know that can change very quickly. So I don't have any faith in it. I got faith in tomorrow's forecast. But other than that, I'm not worried about Sunday until tomorrow at this time. So we look at it that way. Of course, the water's going to clear up. It may take 3 or 4 days. Hopefully, we don't get fronts back to back to back. Just from experience, I didn't fish in Lake Pontchartrain today. Generally, what you'll see ahead of the front, you'll see strong southeast and south winds. And as the front goes by, the wind switch to north, northwest, northeast, and then back to a southeasterly direction. And we had that Thursday and Friday ahead of that front that came through and brought all the rain. So I use the NOAA buoys. I have them on my phone, I have them on my computer. And if you search on them and play with them enough, you'll find down in the bottom corner, it looks like a book. It's a little emblem like a history book. And it's the history of what the wind was doing over the last 24 hours in 6-minute intervals. So you can go back and you can look at that wind and see the direction and the wind speed. So we had winds of anywhere from 15 to 28 miles an hour. Not for a long period of time. It was only that strong for maybe 6 hours while that front was right on top of us. But it's still enough to dirty the water. So you got southeast winds, the opposite shoreline will be dirty. The northwest shoreline and the western shoreline will be dirty. So I monitored that wind pretty much all day on Thursday. And then when Friday came, spoke to my clients to see what their game plan was. I had 2 customers from New York, never caught a fish in Louisiana. So we decided to get some live shrimp. I'm going to fish for speckled trout until 10:30, and then we're going to go catch redfish. So that was our game plan. I went pretty much close to Proctor's Point, which is southeast of Wrigley's or Unknown Pass or even Chef Pass. So I'm going into the direction of where the wind was coming from. So I'm going to the leeward shoreline. I would say the water over there was a 6, maybe a 7. I've got hundreds of shell reefs marked in my GPS. Many years ago, there was lots of gas wells at Lake Borgne that are not there anymore. A lot of people make the mistake of fishing only visible structure. It doesn't have to be visible structure. It can be a shell reef, a natural shell reef, just on the bottom. So I'm out there pretty much by myself, anchored up on a shell reef. We caught a decent number of trout. By 10:30, we left there, went into the marsh and caught some redfish. So it was a very successful day as far as what my customers wanted. But I think the water will continue to clear up, and we'll start seeing more aid development as the days get longer.
Now, we touched on salinity, and we can go on and on about salinity, but let's just get your opinion on if we're placing too much emphasis on salinity, what are the effects, and then do we discourage a trip because salinity is acting on our head?
Well, I tell you my theory. I believe that salinity is only important to a speckled trout when they're spawning. It's only important for egg survival. So they'll just instinctively seek out 15 parts per thousand or higher. Now, there's a great tool that you can all get on your computers and sign up for. Go to the Lake Pontchartrain Basin Foundation's website and sign up for the HydroCoast map. And every 2 weeks, they'll send you an email, and it'll be the southeastern portion of Louisiana, and you'll see contour lines out in the water extending all the way out to Cat Island and even further. And each one of these lines will be a different color, and a different color represents different salinities. So when I have someone in August, when we don't have any salinity in the lake, and they want to catch speckled trout, I'll get on the HydroCoast map and see where there's at least 15 parts per thousand salinity. It may be in Three Mile Bay, it may be in Fish and Smack Bay, it may be even further out. But when I get to those areas, that's when I'm going to start looking for bird activity, bait activity, shrimp on the water, even jellyfish. You don't necessarily have to have a salinity meter. You won't find those little clear jellyfish unless you're in the right salinity of water that you're looking for.
I've never used
the MODIS. I just did a seminar with Sam the other day and he was talking about it. But I've never used it, never been there. But I will. Oh yeah.
Alright, Mike, let's get off the anybody have any questions about fishing for Mike Gallo?
What made you decide where you're going to go? I mean, what, you know, like you just said, salinity makes you go to the next place for speckled trout. That is really pushing you to an area that you just need past years experience.
Well, it depends on the time of year. I can catch
time of year than salinity?
Well, the salinity is important when speckled trout are spawning. That's the only time I'm concerned with it myself. We catch speckled trout. You know, if you look at it backwards, if you don't look at the year and start at January and go all the way around to January, if you start at October, you say speckled trout are in from October all the way to June. So they're here a lot longer than you think they are, but they move out when they're spawning to find that higher salinity. And the telemetry program is really showing a lot of that with the tags that we've put in some of the speckled trout and them migrating out as the salinity drops in late May or June. They're just migrating out deeper and deeper. It's unfortunate that we don't have antennas to find out how far they're going. But we feel like they're going to the edge of the Biloxi Marsh, the eastern edge, where you have that higher salinity, where their eggs are going to survive when they spawn. So only during spawning time, I'm concerned with salinity.
Any other questions for Mike? All right, I got a question for you. Do you recall any kind of charter trip that you've taken people on that sticks out in your mind and burned in your memory? I'd like to hear that. Was it bad or almost died or it was great? I would like that.
Okay, the bad one I can tell you very easily. December 20th, 2004 was the last trip I made where we didn't catch a single fish. So that's easy. That sticks in my mind pretty easily. And you told me you were going to ask me this question, so I was running through my memory. I'm probably approaching 3,000 trips professionally, and the trip that sticks out in my mind was, it's two trips actually. We went in August of 2007 with an older gentleman that was battling cancer, and he had never caught a redfish. Of course, everybody on the boats catch a redfish, except his name was Jimmy. And Jimmy would fish 20 minutes and rest for an hour because the chemo was, you know, taking a toll on him. So towards the end of the day, I started casting, you know, into the spots where I recognized there should be fish. if you do it as long as I have, you can just see the smallest movement of that fork and know you have a bite. So I recognized that I had a bite, and I said, Jimmy, would you hold my rod? It's trolling motors. And of course, he's hooked up on the fish. Well, he caught the fish, and he had a huge smile on his face, and he said something that I hadn't forgotten yet. He said, if I'd have known they were this much fun to catch, I wouldn't have waited 70 years to catch them. So on the way home, I told his nephew, who brought Jimmy fishing with us, I said, look, you got to come in October. I don't have to go as far. It's not so hot. It's not going to be so draining on Jimmy. And we'll catch a lot of fish in October. So sure enough, they came back in October. And I don't know if it was intuition or what, but every fish, all the different species that we caught flounder, redfish, drum, and speckled trout. Jimmy caught the biggest of each species. I had an old-time camera back then, camera phones, I don't know if they were there, but I had an old-time camera back then. I took lots of pictures, and it was a great trip. Well, in January of the next year, his nephew called me and told me that Jimmy had passed away. So I went, I said, I need your address. And I went straight to Walgreens and developed 20-something pictures and mailed them to him, and they used them at his funeral. So it's interesting that you might think I would tell you about a customer catching an 8-pound trout or a 40-pound redfish, but it's actually about a customer that was his last trip. And on his way home, he told his nephew at the October trip, that was the best trip of my life.
Any other questions for Mike? I'm going to let him go. Mike, thanks again for coming out.